Welcome to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm your host, Mickey Huff. It is the KPFA end of the year fund drive for 2022. And today's program, we want to honor past and present anti-war movements. KPFA founder Lewis Hill was a pacifist who founded the station back in 1949, and we want to celebrate that strain and ethos of pacifism today with an anti-war program. We'll be sharing excerpts of a talk Chris Hedges gave in Berkeley for KPFA about his new book, The Greatest Evil is War. Then later in the program, I share a new interview conducted with Medea Benjamin. Medea Benjamin spoke in Berkeley last week, but I'm going to be sharing an interview I did with her prior to that event about her new book, War in Ukraine, Making Sense of a Senseless Conflict. Today on the Project Censored Show, the horrors of war and the promise of peace. Stay tuned. You're listening to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm your host, Mickey Huff. It is the Holiday 2020 Fund Drive here at KPFA, running through Friday, December 16th. The goal is to get $300,000. The post drive will be open until the end of the year, and you can donate securely online during this time at kpfa.org. And up through next Friday, the 16th, you can call 800-439-5732 to pledge your support for community radio. KPFA is offering a holiday audio collection of storytelling for social change, which is an absolutely wonderful collection that I wanted to tell you about right at the outset to get you excited about calling in to support KPFA. We have Howard Zinn, KPFA's Bob Baldock, and Jennifer Stone, and we honor our elders with special audio selections that you'll receive when you support KPFA at any level during the holiday fund drive. So please keep that in mind while the show's going on today and as the fund drive goes on, that we do have at any level of support, you'll get this great holiday audio collection with Howard Zinn and the late, great Bob Baldock, as well as Jennifer Stone, mainstays at KPFA for a long, long time. What we're offering you today at Project Censored, we are going to be offering you the new book by Medea Benjamin and Nicholas Davies called War in Ukraine, Making Sense of a Senseless Conflict. We're also going to be sharing with you audio and video as part of your pledge of support for $100 of the event that we just did last week at the Historic Hillside Club. I hosted Medea Benjamin for that event on December 1st, and we're able to share the audio and video with you for a $100 pledge, which also gets you Medea Benjamin's new book, War in Ukraine, Making Sense of a Senseless Conflict. Today on the show, we're going to begin, however, looking at the horrors of war, the evils of war. We're going to hear an excerpt from Pulitzer Prize winner Chris Hedges about his new book, The Greatest Evil is War. Earlier in the fall, I had the honor of hosting Chris Hedges for another KPFA special. We're going to share some of that with you today to set up our talk with Medea Benjamin, as the theme of our program today is in honor of anti-war movements past and present, and while we also honor prospects for peace. $100 pledge gets you Medea Benjamin's new book, War in Ukraine, along with the audio and video of the event that took place about the book December 1st in Berkeley at the Historic Hillside Club. Call 800-439-5732 during the program to get this great offer with Medea Benjamin's book and audio video. But right now, I want to share excerpts with you from Chris Hedges, The Greatest Evil is War. Chris Hedges, welcome back to the Project Censored Show.
Thanks, Mickey.
Chris, you took a long hiatus from writing a book about war. Certainly, you've commented on it. You comment on it on your programs, both at RT and now the Real News Network. You address these issues in your writing at Sheer Post. But talk to us about this book, The Greatest Evil is War.
Well, when I finished War is a Force That Gives Us Meaning, which, to the surprise of myself and the publisher, was a massive bestseller, big commercial publishers came at me to write another book on war, which I didn't want to do. I didn't want to get trapped into this kind of process of diminishing returns. And so I turned down some very lucrative advances and wrote a book called Losing Moses on the Freeway. It was originally called The Decalogue, on how one of the issues of the Ten Commandments, which precede the Old Testament, six of them are lifted directly from the Egyptian Book of the Dead, can dominate, distort, and even destroy lives. But of course, war is something that I'm intimately familiar with, covering the conflict in El Salvador for 5 years, 7 years in the Middle East, and then covering the war in the former Yugoslavia. And so I continued to write on issues of war. At one point, I collected interviews with 50 combat veterans from Iraq on atrocities that they had either witnessed or participated in with Leila El Aryan, and published a book called Collateral Damage, which came out of a long magazine piece, a long investigative piece that we published in The Nation. But yes, you're right. I kind of skirted that issue intentionally, and City Light, Seven Story Press came, especially because I had written some very sharp critiques of NATO and of the expansion of NATO in Eastern and Central Europe. I'd covered the revolutions in East Germany, Czechoslovakia, and Romania. I was there for the collapse of the Soviet Union. I was acutely aware that NATO had been rendered obsolete. NATO was created in 1949 to prevent Soviet expansion into Eastern and Central Europe. It had become redundant. There were promises made to Gorbachev that NATO would not be expanded beyond the borders of a unified Germany. Everyone, and I find myself in agreement, surprisingly, with Henry Kissinger on this issue, that this was an unnecessary provocation. I mean, George Kennan called it the gravest mistake of the post-Cold War era, the expansion of NATO. So they wanted to put some of these essays together with perhaps past writings, and you're right, that I, for both Truthdig and Sheerpost and other places, had written on war, not in book form. And I went back, and in fact, there was quite a large body, surprisingly large body of writing on war that we then put together in this book to examine various facets of war. Those people like Robert Kagan and Victoria Nuland, these kind of neocons, Samantha Power, liberal interventionists who promote war, and then, of course, are lavishly funded by the war industry. Most of these think tanks, the Brookings Institute and everything else, gets a lot of money from the war industry. We had gone out and visited Thomas Young, who was wounded in Iraq and was a paraplegic, and helped him. He couldn't hold a pen while he dictated, write his last letter to Bush and Cheney. There's a long piece about a woman in the Marine Corps who works in the mortuary unit and has to prepare the bodies. And I think that each is a kind of window into the vast enterprise of death that war is. And it helped, of course, that I come out of that environment and understand it.
Indeed, Chris Hedges, we're going to talk a little bit more about that later on in our conversation. You have some riveting, chilling accounts of soldiers' tales and existential crisis, corpses when bodies come home. You go into great detail and share these first-person accounts of the horrors of war, which make for very powerful storytelling. Important lessons embedded here. You begin the book by saying preemptive war, whether in Iraq or Ukraine, is a war crime. And of course, earlier this year, Russia invaded Ukraine. You, of course, very quickly in the next sentence say it does not matter if the war is launched on the basis of lies and fabrications, as was the case in Iraq, or because of the breaking of a series of agreements with Russia, including the promise by Washington not to extend NATO beyond the borders of a unified Germany, not to deploy thousands of NATO troops in Central and Eastern Europe, not to meddle in internal affairs of nations on Russia's border. You go on and on to contextualize this right out of the beginning. So I'm, of course, imagining that what was happening earlier this year, 2022, was some spark for this project.
That was their spark. So that's what triggered the request to put the book together, which, by the way, I initially refused to do for the reasons that I said earlier, and that I was loath to do a kind of pale reflection of war as a force that gives us meaning, which draws on my own personal experiences in war over two decades. But this book is different because it's drawing on the experience of people I interviewed. So there's very little, there is some, but very little in there of my own experience in war. And I think that it's the whole sort of jingoism around the war in Ukraine and the binary view of the world and the demonization of Putin, who, like Saddam Hussein, suddenly becomes the new Hitler, and just the complete naivete or unwillingness to examine what the enterprise of war does. It's going to destroy Ukraine. They're going to have to talk one day. And as Kissinger said, they're going to have to exchange land for peace. But of course, Washington sees this like it did when it supported the Mujahideen in Afghanistan against the Soviets as a way to cripple and perhaps remove Putin from power. But it's a very cynical game because the people who are going to pay are the Ukrainians and, of course, the Russians and their families.
Chris Edges, I think a chapter very early in the book, very important and something that you've written about at length, riffing on Edward Herman and Noam Chomsky's concept on worthy and unworthy victims and media framing. Could you talk about that and how that's so greatly at play? And of course, how that was a theme in some part on your program at RT America, which was discontinued when the station came off the air.
It's a very important point that we have a very kind of selective morality when it comes to international affairs and war, that we very consciously divide the world into what they call worthy and unworthy victims, those we're allowed to pity, such as Ukrainians, and those such as Palestinians whose suffering is minimized or ignored. So you saw at the height of the Iraq War, with all of the atrocities that were being carried out by Allied forces, primarily NATO and American forces, against Iraqi civilians, but the Palestinians, the Syrians, the Libyans, the Somalis, the Yemenis, the Iraqis, these civilians also deserve our empathy and understanding. And unfortunately, the press amplifies this bifurcation of the world into worthy and unworthy victims. For me, one of the first experiences with this was when I was covering the war in El Salvador in 1984. You had a Catholic Polish priest who was murdered by the regime in Poland, and the Reagan administration and the press used that murder to excoriate the Polish communist government, and yet the Reagan administration had worked to cover up the rape and murder of four Catholic missionaries in El Salvador by the Salvadoran National Guard, even casting aspersions on the women. Jean Kirkpatrick, who was the ambassador of the United Nations, said the nuns weren't just nuns, they were political activists. Secretary of State Alexander Haig speculated that they probably ran a roadblock. And that's a perfect kind of example of what we do to decide who is worthy of empathy, who is worthy of justice, who is worthy of support, and who isn't. And as someone who spent 20 years outside of the United States, this was quite maddening, especially spending much of my time covering the plight of the Palestinians. And the press signs on for the project. So the press is as much to blame as the political leadership.
You're listening to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm your host, Mickey Huff. It's the KPFA end of the year fund drive for 2022. The fund drive goes through December 16th. We need to get $300,000. And you can help us reach our goal by calling 800-439-5732. That's 800-HEY-KPFA. You can pledge securely online at kpfa.org. Today's program looks at the significance of anti-war movements, the need for anti-war movements. It looks at the horrors and evils of war, which are many, but it also looks at the prospects for peace and for negotiation. Medea Benjamin wrote a new book with Nicholas Davies called War in Ukraine, Making Sense of a Senseless Conflict, and that's what we're offering today for a $100 pledge, along with audio and video of the talk that she gave at the historic Hillside Club in Berkeley. I had the honor of hosting Medea Benjamin for that event. $100 gets you the book and the audio video of that event with Medea Benjamin, but you've got to call now, 800-439-5732. I would love to get 20 callers at the $100 rate today. If we could get 20 people calling in, we'd love if you'd call in with your support for this kind of programming today. 800-439-5732, securely online at kpfa.org. For any amount, if you pledge any amount, you get the wonderful holiday audio collection, Storytelling for Social Change, with the amazing Howard Zinn, who would have been 100 years old this year. His classic book, of course, A People's History of the United States. And of course, also the holiday collection honors two KPFA elders who have just passed on, the great Bob Baldock, with whom I had the pleasure of working on KPFA events for several years, as well as Jennifer Stone. And that ties in with today's message, the anti-war message, the anti-violence and pro-peace message that goes along with our thank you premium for supporting KPFA and the Project Censored Show. We are offering you $100. You get War in Ukraine, Making Sense of a Senseless Conflict, and the audio video of the talk Medea Benjamin did in Berkeley for KPFA December 1 that I hosted. But you need to call now, 800-439-5732. 800-439-5732. $100 gets you the Medea Benjamin pack. Any amount gets you the holiday audio collection, Storytelling for Social Change with Howard Zinn, Bob Baldock, and also Jennifer Stone. With that, here are more excerpts from Chris Hedges' The Greatest Evil is War. Chris Hedges, you were just talking a little bit about some of the soldiers that you had talked to. You mentioned another Robert Weilbacher. Are there another couple people or another person that you'd like to bring forward? I think that these are really important parts of your book, as you mentioned earlier, that these people are telling the stories and you're basically sort of a conduit for people to really see the horrors of war.
Robert went on to apply for CO, conscientious objectors, which they'll make it easy once you're active duty. Jess Goodell is another one. She was the Marine who worked in the mortuary affairs unit in Iraq. So she collected the bodies and the body parts of Marines. And just that those details of what it's like when the body comes in. You have to go through the pockets. You find the notes. You find the pictures of their family. And most of the people who were killed carried lists, things they wanted to do when they got home, food they wanted to eat, pictures, of course, of their wife, kids, family, mothers, fathers, and they're young, as young as 18 years old. And they also had to deal with suicide because hazing is rife within elite units. That's something Spencer went through in the Rangers, but it's very prevalent in the Marines. I spent 3 months with the U.S. Marine Corps. I went into Iraq with 1st Battalion, 1st Marines. And hazing, which is always part of the military culture, is more pronounced in a combat zone, partly because there's no oversight. And it can be very brutal. You can be, this is Marine Corps language, quote-unquote bitch for a day, where they treat you with contempt and make you do all sorts of ridiculous things like carry bricks from one side to the enclosure to the other and tease people. These are people who just perhaps don't fit in, or at least in the eyes of the dominant group doesn't fit in. And one of the things she had to do, they would often go to the porta potties and put the barrel of their automatic weapon under their chin and blow their brains out. And the mortuary unit, they'd have to go and scrape the body parts off the walls of the porta potty and send them home. So again, that's a kind of another window into military culture and military life.
Chris Hedges, you also, of course, invoke history as a great teacher, and of course, past often is prologue. You talk about the myths around war, and particularly you dissect some of the more poignant myths about the United States' own civil war, and you talk even about World War II. Those are two significant conflicts in U.S. history that are often lionized and draped in valor and principles and so forth. Can you talk about the propaganda and weaponization of history in that regard?
That's always done. It's even done in Homer. So Homer will look back to the golden age of heroes. And then, of course, Homer became mythologized. Alexander the Great used to reportedly carry a copy of the Iliad. Actually, when I was captured in Iraq, I was captured by the Iraqi Republican Guard in the Basra uprising. I had a copy of the Iliad in my pocket because it is one of the truly great books on war. And we do the same with World War II, with the Civil War. And so in this particular essay, I talk about Gettysburg. I'm descended from three brothers who fought at Gettysburg, one of whom was a Union general, one of whom was a colonel in the elite Iron Brigade, and then my great-great-grandfather, David Edwards, who was a sergeant in the 5th Maine, eventually wounded at Battle of the Wilderness. And just what the reality of Gettysburg was like. And I have my great-great-grandfather's diaries and letters which explain the savagery of that war. I mean, over 50,000 soldiers were killed or wounded in Gettysburg, and they died in terrible agony. The hospitals were improvised, unsanitary. In fact, when my great-great-grandfather is wounded, he has to walk for 2 or 3 days back to the hospital. He was shot in the shoulder, but he was mobile. But he passes all sorts of people who are just dying, like World War I, just dying where they were left. So it's a way to kind of attempt to puncture that myth. And I mention at the end of that my uncle was in the South Pacific in World War II and came back, he was wounded, came back a physical and emotional wreck. drank himself to death. And I tie my grandmother into it. So my grandmother was 8 years old when they buried her grandfather, who had fought in the Civil War. And that wound dominated the rest of his life. And then her own son was destroyed by World War II.
Chris Hedges, you incorporate so many of these rich stories into the text of The Greatest Evil is War. It's not subtle in its approach. Your message is very clear that war is a horrible, horrible thing. Yet it's all around us. And you write toward the end of the book, you have a whole chapter on the permanent war. And of course, you go back and look, whether it's through Orwell or other literary folks, you write about how these themes just persist in our culture. Even though we have critics, we have people that have analyzed this and tried to call this out. You talk about Seymour Melman's Pentagon Capitalism, The Political Economy of War. You mentioned the great book, often forgotten, J. William Fulbright, The Pentagon Propaganda Machine That Shapes Public Opinion. I mean, the permanent war machine is what requires the grist of bodies to perpetuate this kind of transnational corporate capitalism and raping of the planet's resources and destruction of the global population. So this is an entire military-industrial complex, as Eisenhower warned us in his farewell address in 1961.
Well, yes, it's late empire, Toynbee writes about this, are usually destroyed by unchecked militarism. It consumes half of all discretionary spending. It's a bedrock of the American economy. It dominates foreign policy in terms of our response to the rest of the world. The architects of permanent war have thrust us from one military debacle starting in Vietnam, the 20 years in the Middle East, into the next with no accountability, and it's distorted and destroyed the economy, it's militarized the society, and you can't critique it. It seized control of the centers of information, both in Hollywood and in the news industry. And this kind of standardization, uniformity of public discourse around war essentially creates a situation where there's no check on this, what is this disemboweling of the country. It's also militarized our society, so that, quoting Thucydides, the tyranny that Athens imposed on others it finally imposed on itself. But all of the mechanisms, militarized drones, wholesale surveillance, militarized police departments, the largest prison system in the world. Remember that those people in Abu Ghraib who went there and carried out these acts of torture had been carrying out acts of torture within the U.S. prison system. So it's Alexander Berkman in the beginning of World War I called the German military the enemy from within. And that's precisely what it is. How do we stop it? Well, neither of the two ruling parties have any intent of standing up to the war machine, which has become a state within a state. $813 billion for fiscal year 2023. That's more than the next nine countries, including China and Russia combined. It's devastating the economy because it monopolizes capital. U.S. debt is over $30 trillion, $6 trillion more than the U.S. GDP. And servicing the debt costs $300 billion a year. It's just completely unsustainable. So this is the cancer within the body politic, is, you know, what Eisenhower called the military-industrial complex.
You're listening to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm your host, Mickey Huff. Well, right now, I'd like shift gears and start sharing with you an interview that I did with Medea Benjamin just before she spoke in Berkeley December 1st for her event on a new book, War in Ukraine, Making Sense of a Senseless Conflict. I'm going to share with you excerpts of the conversation she and I had, but for a $100 pledge, you get the talk she gave about the book, War in Ukraine, on December 1st. You get the book, you get the audio video of that event, and you also get the pleasure and satisfaction of knowing that you're supporting community radio here at the end of the year for the KPFA Holiday Fund Drive. Any amount gets you the Storytelling for Social Change Holiday Audio Collection with Howard Zinn and KPFA's own Bob Baldock in conversation with Sasha Lilly, talking about his life on the left, fighting with Fidel Castro, the Cuban Revolution. Bob Baldock was living history. And we pay respects to him here today, the long life he had and the support he gave to KPFA for years. We also celebrate distinguished monologuist Jennifer Stone and Stone's Throw with her unique voice of wit and wisdom. Any amount gets you that special audio collection. But $100 is what we're looking for today. If you can do it, you get Medea Benjamin's new book, War in Ukraine, and also the talk she gave in Berkeley, audio and video, that I hosted December 1st. 800-439-5732. Project Censored's been on the air since 2010. We're on 50 stations across the country, and I am honored and proud to be part of the KPFA community and family with all of you. And I would really appreciate also seeing you call in during this hour to show your love for this kind of programming, these kind of guests, and the work that folks like Chris Hedges and Medea Benjamin do. I am going to now share with you the interview I did with Medea Benjamin before her visit to Berkeley. We discussed her book, War in Ukraine, Making Sense of a Senseless Conflict. Keep the calls coming. Pledge online, kpfa.org. Here's Medea Benjamin. Medea Benjamin, welcome back to the Project Censored Show.
Nice to be on with you, Mickey.
You wrote this in pretty record time, in a couple of months earlier this year, and this book is already out. So obviously the book comes out of a sense of urgency of what's happening with Russia, Ukraine, and NATO. Tell us about how this book came together so quickly.
Well, Mickey, as you well know, in past experiences, let's just say post 9/11, the anti-war movement has had some difficulties building up and opposition, but yet a lot of clarity when it's our own government that is the aggressor, like when we invaded Afghanistan or invaded Iraq or invaded Somalia. And it's much easier to organize people around this, get them to see that the U.S. imperial design is hurting people across the globe. This is a different situation where if you look at the war inside Ukraine, the civil war that then the Russians interfered with their direct intervention on February 24th, Russia is the aggressor. If you look at it as a geopolitical war, well, then you can put a lot of the blame on the United States for its aggression. But it's a very confusing situation because of those two wars happening at the same time. And so even the people who have been with us on the anti-war issues for decades are now suddenly scratching their heads and saying, well, wait a minute, you know, I'm with the underdog and that's Ukraine. And so I support the US-NATO position. And I even have friends who were sworn pacifists for their almost entire lives. And now they're suddenly saying, yes, we've got to send more and more weapons into Ukraine. I don't know, Mickey, if you're experiencing the same thing.
Actually, Medea, yes. We've seen that a lot on the left. It's quite perplexing. One can hold multiple views simultaneously. It may create cognitive dissonance, but one can condemn the Russian invasion and also look at the history. And that's what you do in your book. This isn't both sides-ism. This is literally looking at how this war was set. You go back, of course, further, but you do talk about the 2014 coup, the failure of the Minsk II peace plan. So could you give a little bit of a backdrop as to why you're arguing that this is a complicated war, particularly in terms of those who are seeking out or were formerly anti-war?
The reason we did this book and doing the speaking tour is because we have to have these discussions with people. And even those we consider among the progressive community, this choir is not singing together on this one. And so we really need some very profound conversations. And I'm enjoying traveling around the country, speaking to people. And I think it's great that people are coming out who hold different opinions. But we have to have those conversations and recognize, as you said, that we can hold two different thoughts in our brains, which is condemning the Russians for their invasion and understanding the provocations of the United States and NATO. And I find it quite remarkable when people say, well, you know, NATO really had nothing to do with this. The Russians accepted that NATO was going to continue and was going to expand, and there was never any treaty. So we go into great detail in our book, quoting person after person after person who's in these high up positions, like ambassadors to Russia at the time, or people who were insider academics or diplomats, you know, all kinds of people saying, this is a red line. Expansion of NATO will not be a good thing. Don't do it. Don't do it. And that came up in 1991. It came up then when Bill Clinton was in. It came up when George Bush was in. So it's come through the different administrations, but there's warning after warning. There's warning coming from the Russians. There's warning coming from the Europeans. There's warnings coming from the US. There's the 2008 meeting, the NATO meeting, where it was George Bush who's saying, we're going to offer NATO membership to Ukraine and Georgia. And the Europeans are saying, don't think it's a good idea. Don't think it's a good idea. And then Bush basically pushes it through. So it's important to get a copy of the book, to read that chapter about NATO expansion, to dispel the myths, and also the myth that we were taught even before this invasion, Mickey, is that NATO was some kind of defensive alliance. But, you know, you don't have to just look at this particular incident. You could look at NATO searching for a new purpose after the downfall of the Soviet Union, saying, oh my gosh, you know, if we're going to go to the way of the Warsaw Pact and dissolve, we better find some other raison d'etre, and looking around the world far away from the Atlantic to get involved in all kinds of military misadventures and pushing for other countries to spend the massive amounts on their military that we spend in the United States. And, you know, Mickey, we have a lot of friends in Europe who have an organization called Say No to NATO. And when this goal of NATO was to spend 2% of your gross domestic product on the military, they came back and say, hey, you know, we don't want to be like the United States with no healthcare system, no free college education, because you're spending so much on your military. We are trying to hold the line and not increase the military budget. But yet NATO was always there pushing and pushing. And people like Donald Trump, who at one point said NATO was obsolete, then turned around and said, no. What I mean is that you in Europe have to spend more of your money buying our weapons. So we go into great detail in the book to understand that NATO is an aggressive alliance, that having U.S. bases and NATO surrounding Russia was a bad thing, was going to cause a direct conflict. And unfortunately, Russia really fell into that trap that was set for them by the U.S. and the Western nations.
Medea Benjamin, you mentioned NATO looking for more to get into. They're now getting into media literacy in the U.S. to fight propaganda. NATO is actually now sponsoring media literacy education, quote unquote, to deconstruct Russian propaganda. That's their only interest. They're not worried about their own or anything else. Back to your book, you have a preface written by Katrina Vandenhovel of The Nation. Her late husband, Stephen Cohen, a Russia studies expert, was one of the few voices of sanity over the last several years. And you clearly are channeling a lot of that throughout the book. And you just mentioned there seems to only be a handful of people, you included, Chris Hedges. His new book, The Greatest Evil is War, really focuses on the problems around Ukraine, especially. There seems to be a dearth, but there don't seem to be enough people with the courage to speak out in the U.S. because there's been a massive propaganda campaign here, a massive campaign against anybody who wants to question the U.S.-NATO narrative.
Well, you know, yes and no. Stephen Cohen, I just adored him, and his analysis was so important and profound. But there are a lot of people. The problem is they don't get to have their op-eds in the Washington Post or the New York Times, and they don't get on the CNN and others. There's Katrina Vandenhoeven herself. There's people like Noam Chomsky. There's John Mersheimer, who had predicted this long ago. There's Jeffrey Sachs, who's been doing some fantastic interviews. But as he said himself, I can't get an op-ed in the mainstream papers, and I get shut out of corporate TV as well. There's Patrick Coburn, there's Aaron Maté, there's a lot of us that are putting out really good information. I write op-eds maybe every other week. I did get one in the San Jose Mercury News, by the way. That was good. But the LA Times keep rejecting them. Even the San Francisco Chronicle keeps rejecting. It is very hard for us to get our voices out there. And that's why people are so confused, because the propaganda is relentless. And Mickey, one of the things that I think is the worst on the propaganda is this idea that Putin is crazy and you can't talk to him, and that this is a winnable war. And every time the media comes out and says, oh, wow, look what Ukraine did. They managed to take this back and this back. And yes, you know, they have been fighting very hard on the front lines. But yet then Russia turns around and has countermeasures. And these countermeasures are brutal, and it is causing civilians to be killed, more people to flee, again, a new refugee crisis when they're hitting the civilian infrastructure. But that has to be in the context of this war will not be won on the battlefield, and you keep it going and you'll just get more misery, more suffering. And that's not the way that the media is portraying it. They're portraying it as keep this going and Ukraine will win back every single inch of territory that the Russians have taken.
It's the underdog thesis, as you had mentioned before. You write here, too, that there has been more Western media coverage of the Ukraine war. In the U.S., there's been more coverage than the invasion of Iraq. You write that there was more coverage of what's happening in Ukraine than when we started the war in Iraq.
Absolutely. I mean, we never had this coverage that went on every single day for months at a time. The media got bored with Iraq after we stopped winning. And basically, I think most people didn't know that the U.S. continued to be there year after year. This relentless coverage of the war in Ukraine is something very different. And we don't see the other wars that are happening at the same time. So let's take the issue of Yemen, where the war has been going on now for 8 years, and where the U.S. is supplying the Saudis with the bombs that have been killing children, destroying infrastructure, destroying clinics and hospitals. And the people of Yemen are in infinitely worse situation as refugees, or as people trying to flee, displaced people, than the Ukrainians, where the world has really poured out their hearts and their wallets to help the Ukrainian refugees. So we've been saying, why don't you cover the U.S.-supported Saudi atrocities that are happening in Yemen? Why didn't you continue to cover the U.S. atrocities in Afghanistan and, of course, in Iraq and Libya? So the media has been so one-sided on showing the terrible atrocities committed by Russia, but never showing the similar kinds of things when it's the U.S. And it also leads to this idea that how are we going to hold the Russians accountable, which is an important question, but then the U.S. has never been held accountable.
You're listening to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm your host, Mickey Huff. This is the Project Censored Show for the KPFA Holiday Fund Drive, the end of 2022. I'm trying to raise at least $2,000 this hour with $100 pledges if possible. You get the new book by Medea Benjamin and Nicholas Davies, War in Ukraine, Making Sense of a Senseless Conflict. It is a startling book for folks that only listen to corporate media or even so-called public media of NPR, where we hear almost no anti-war voices about the conflict in Ukraine. This is a very nuanced book, by the way. This is not a book that praises Putin or Russia. In fact, quite frankly, it calls out not only the illegal invasion Russia has in Ukraine and the horrors of what's happening in Ukraine, but it also calls out the many authoritarian problems that exist in Russia. In no way does this book praise what's happening with Russia or give any comfort or support to the Russian invasion. It is an anti-war book in the same sense that Chris Hedges' Greatest Evil is War. Medea Benjamin and Nicholas Davies have written a great anti-war book. Noam Chomsky calls it careful, informed, judicious, and invaluable guide. Chris Hedges says War in Ukraine makes tragically clear that this was a conflict that could have been avoided if our own foreign policy had not become captive to militarists whose sole loyalty is to the arms industry. $100 pledged now gets you War in Ukraine, the book by Medea Benjamin and Nicholas Davies. It also gets you the audio and video of the talk that Medea gave December 1st at the Historic Hillside Club. that I had the honor of hosting. Any amount gets you KPFA's audio collection with Howard Zinn, Bob Baldock, and Jennifer Stone. But again, now is the time to give. It's the end of the year, right? A donation to KPFA is deductible, but you need to call 800-439-5732 in order to do it. Go to kpfa.org online to pledge securely and look at the other gifts. There are plenty of amazing gifts, amazing resources to share with your family, your friends, your teacher friends, libraries, schools. KPFA, as Dennis Bernstein of Flashpoint said, is the university of the airwaves. And I truly believe that it is an amazing educational tool, community radio. And KPFA, I think, is one of the purest examples of how this can work. But it doesn't work without your help and support. This is your station. Please call 800-439-5732 now and support KPFA for this fund drive. $100 gets you Medea Benjamin's new book, War in Ukraine, Making Sense of a Senseless Conflict, and also the audio video of the talk she gave December 1st at the Hillside Club. Call 800-439-5732. Any amount gets you the special holiday audio collection with Howard Zinn, Bob Baldock in conversation with Sasha Lilly and Jennifer Stone. But we really'd like to see you call in with the $100 mark, if you can, to get the Medea Benjamin pack. 800-439-5732, online at kpfa.org. Here is more of my conversation with Medea Benjamin about the war in Ukraine. We're speaking with author and activist Medea Benjamin, co-founder of Code Pink, author of several books, including most recently, just out with Nicholas Davies, War in Ukraine, Making Sense of a Senseless Conflict. It has a preface by Katrina Vandenhovel. And Noam Chomsky calls this a careful, informed, judicious study, and it's an invaluable guide to understanding Russia's criminal invasion of Ukraine, and most crucially, how we can act to help bring this terrible tragedy to an end. Medea Benjamin, we were talking about the double standards and how the West covers worthy and unworthy victims. Palestine, chief among them, another one in the long list of atrocities. There's something you talk about in the book about how refugees are treated.
It's quite astounding. Even when the U.S. said they were going to create a separate way for the Afghans who worked for 20 years with the U.S. to get them out and bring them into the United States, the U.S. has reneged on that and left Afghans hanging both inside Afghanistan and in third countries still trying to get in here. But the Ukrainians, the doors have been wide open. In fact, Mickey, they actually created a separate line on the border with Mexico that was just for Ukrainians, and they got processed immediately, where people have been living on that border for over a year trying to get in, people fleeing desperate situations from around the world. And this is known to people, and you see in Latin America, for example, cartoons that have come out showing Haitians being whipped at the border while Ukrainians, white Ukrainians, are being greeted with open arms and immediately taken in and given all kinds of help. So, you know, what we say in the book, we even show how the foreigners who were living in Ukraine from other countries, African, Indian, how they were treated when they tried to escape, sometimes not even being let on the buses and the trains with the other refugees, and how the African countries had to come out and denounce Ukraine for the discrimination against their citizens. We show it as a very racist kind of look. But we also say that the way that Ukrainian refugees have been treated should be a model for how other refugees are treated. Let's open our arms. Let's open our homes. Let's open our wallets. Let's treat people with dignity like we are treating the Ukrainians. So we are trying in the book to show that the U.S. has been taking the very serious issues of this war and politicizing them, sensationalizing them, and turning them into propaganda that doesn't allow the American people to have a critical view of what's really happening, which would allow them to put the kind of pressure on our politicians that we need. I feel like we have a very, very uneducated mass of people when it comes to so many issues, but we're talking about this particular issue about Ukraine. This is a life and death issue. This is an issue that could lead us into a nuclear war. This is the time when you really realize how horrible it is that we don't have a press that can educate people in an objective way and that can turn the population into one that has opinions that would really help to put this war into perspective.
Medea Benjamin, so the Annie Leibovitz Vogue photo spread of the Zelenskys didn't sway you or pull on your heartstrings?
No, I thought that was terrible. I mean, I don't think that we need to show photos of the Zelenskys in any way that is going to make people feel more sympathy for them. I mean, they have the best PR that I've ever seen in modern warfare history. And you know, this is not to say that they don't deserve to have their voices heard, but then we hear nothing from the other side. I sometimes turn on RT on my computer, Russia Today, just because I feel I need to hear what they're saying. I don't have to believe it. You know, the truth is somewhere in between. So if you recognize you're getting purely the Ukrainian side and that the Western media is 100% on that side, don't you want to see a little bit at least at what the other side is saying so that you can make up your own mind and find some, perhaps, some position that is not one based on propaganda?
You talk about RT America in the book and how it was deplatformed, not censored by the U.S. government, but censored by proxy, by big tech and corporations that took it off the air. Chris Hedges' show, Abby Martin's archives, Lee Camp's show, all disappeared. I mean, and again, those folks were all against the war. They're against the Russian war and invasion on the RT network. I mean, Hedges didn't talk about it much on the air. It wasn't what his show was about, and Abby was gone. But what do you make of the silencing of those voices? Yet we have in the U.S. the Associated Press publishing falsehoods about Russia allegedly firing missiles into Poland, not checking any of the sources. Turns out AP was wrong. The sources were wrong. Russia didn't attack Poland. That's a World War III kind of incident, according to NATO charter, no?
Absolutely. And to have AP, which gets out all over the world, saying this immediately, that this was coming from Russia. I mean, my heart sunk when I heard that those two people had been killed in Poland and the immediate assumption that it was a Russian missile. I thought, okay, this is it. This is what we've been dreading. This is World War III coming on. And to know that the media put that out without the sources, and then it was the president of Poland himself who had to come out and say, no, this actually wasn't a Russian missile. This came from Ukraine. And then having Zelensky say, no, not true. It wasn't ours. It came from Russia. Luckily, we got the truth out and cooler heads prevailed. And you can see why people inside the Pentagon and the U.S. and the head of the CIA and the National Security Council wanted to immediately put out, well, no, this wasn't coming from Russia, because they don't want to see this go into World War III. They don't want to be directly involved in this war. They will prefer to keep this war going and have the Ukrainians fighting and dying than to have one U.S. soldier be killed in Ukraine. But yes, it's a horrific example of the media jumping on something, putting out a false narrative that could have been extremely dangerous and luckily was quickly walked back.
Caitlin Johnson has a recent article about this. The AP editor, one of the editors said, quote, "We've got a rule about needing two sources, but maybe not this time," referring to the anonymous intel source on the alleged Russian attack on Poland. The second editor says, "A single source in U.S. intel can't be wrong. Let's run this in the way most likely to suggest imminent nuclear war." 1 week later, AP, the reporter, screwed up. Why is RT fake news but not this? It's another example of that double standard in the propaganda in the information war.
And let's look at the issue of the Nord Stream pipeline and the blowing up of that. I mean, you look at what is the logical thing. Who was against the building of the pipeline to begin with? Who said they could blow it up? Who would benefit from it? Well, US, UK, US, UK. And then who did it? Well, it was immediately put out that it's the Russians. And that continues to be put out. And that is quite incredible. And when you have people who manage to get on the media and start talking about the reality of who would most likely be the culprit, they immediately get cut off, as happened to Jeffrey Sachs himself. So it's another example of how the media doesn't want to get down to the real issues and likes to perpetuate these either total lies or misconceptions that frame the issue for the American people.
So, Medea, we have a few minutes left, and I want to get to really the crux of what this is about. This is an anti-war book. There have been a couple of really good anti-war books this year, but the anti-war movement in the U.S. has been pretty moribund. As you know, you've been in the thick of it for so long, and it just seems that the U.S. got so whipped up in support of what was happening with Ukraine just goes to show how easily the population can be led, just like with the WMD scandal in Iraq. What do you really hope happens? What do you hope comes out of this book? And how do you see it connecting to a reinvigoration of an anti-war, pro-peace movement? Not just anti-war, but pro-peace movement.
I feel like the more we educate people, the more people will join in this call for a ceasefire and negotiations. And it's quite remarkable that in this moment, the call to negotiate with the Russians and to call on the Ukrainians to go negotiate is seen as Putin apologist, is seen as appeasement, as seen as treacherous to the Democratic Party. It is just so insane when you have a war that could so easily become a trigger for a nuclear war or for a World War III, that you're not doing everything in your power, if you're Biden, if you're Secretary of State Anthony Blinken, to try to calm the situation and get to the negotiating table. But instead, they're saying, no, 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 no. So we need a groundswell from the bottom up to say yes to negotiations and ceasefire, to say no to pouring billions and billions of more dollars in to keep this war going while Ukrainians are dying every day.
You're listening to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm your host, Mickey Huff. Today, we've been listening to excerpts of an interview I did with Medea Benjamin. We were talking about her latest book with Nicholas Davies, War in Ukraine, Making Sense of a Senseless Conflict. Earlier in the program, we shared excerpts of Chris Hedges on issues of war and peace, Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist, his recent book, The Greatest Evil is War. So today on the program, we've really been pushing this theme of having an anti-war stance and the importance of anti-war voices in a country like the United States that's been at war pretty much since its inception. 800-439-5732. KPFA.org, $100 gets you Medea Benjamin's book and the audio video of the event we did December 1st. War is a racket. Smedley Butler, one of the most decorated Marines in U.S. history in the first part of the 20th century, said, quote, I spent 33 years and 4 months in active military service, and during that period, I spent most of my time as a high-class muscle man for big business, for Wall Street, and the bankers. In short, I was a racketeer, a gangster for capitalism. Smedley Butler, in his 1935 pamphlet and book, War is a Racket, went on to talk about how he invaded and had military exploits at the behest of the U.S. government in Mexico to make it safe for American oil interests, in Haiti and Cuba for the National City Bank. He also invaded half a dozen Central American republics for Wall Street, Nicaragua for the international banking house of the Brown Brothers, the Dominican Republic for American sugar, Honduras for American fruit. In China, he helped pave the way for Standard Oil. Smedley Butler reminded us war is a racket, and he said, quote, looking back on it, I might have given Al Capone a few hints. The best he could do was operate his racket in three districts. I operated on three continents. Well, indeed, people like Chris Hedges and Medea Benjamin know all too well that war is a racket, always was, always will be. and it's an amazing racket for the military-industrial complex. Of course, the first casualty when war comes is truth. Whether we go back to the ancient Greeks or 1918 U.S. Senator Hiram Warren Johnson, we were warned over and over that the first casualty of war is truth. And unfortunately, the war in Ukraine has been no different. If you want to hear what's going on behind the scenes and how we got here and what are the pretexts and what were the provocation incidents leading up to this war, by the way, no justification for the Russian actions and Putin's invasion of Ukraine. It's an illegal action. War crimes are being committed and need to be exposed and opposed at every turn. But we also don't want to shut the door on peace and negotiations. And Medea Benjamin and Nicholas Davies remind us that vividly in their new book, War in Ukraine, Making Sense of a Senseless Conflict. This is a great book to share with people, particularly liberals, that say, well, we can't stand by and watch the desecration and destruction of Ukraine. Understood. But we also don't want to get sucked into the morass of war where we're putting $100 billion into the war in Ukraine on top of our already nearly trillion-dollar military budget. Less than half of that could cure homelessness in the U.S. But we don't have the political will. We always have bipartisan political will for war, however, and the military-industrial complex never says no. It always gets what it wants because we don't say no to it. And to help you make sense of a senseless conflict, call now 800-439-5732. 800-439-5732. KPFA.org. $100 gets you this book, War in Ukraine, and it gets you the audio and video of the talk Medea did in Berkeley to a packed house December 1st at the historic Hillside Club. Any amount gets you the audio collection, Storytelling for Social Change, Howard Zinn, Bob Baldock, Jennifer Stone. But the important thing here in the last minutes we have is for you to call and show your support for this station. We need to understand the evils and horrors of war and why the prospects for peace are so significant and need support. $100 gets you Medea Benjamin's new book, War in Ukraine, and the talk she gave in Berkeley, but you need to call now to get it. 800-439-5732. As Smedley Butler said, war is a racket. It always has been. It is possibly the oldest, easily most profitable, surely the most vicious. It is the only one international in scope. It is the only one in which profits are reckoned in dollars and the losses in lives. Well, we would actually like to see some of your dollars, if possible, sent to this station to support this kind of programming and to support these kind of voices that you don't hear anywhere in the corporate media. Call now to support this kind of anti-war program. 800-439-5732. $100 gets you the war in Ukraine, Making Sense of a Senseless Conflict by Medea Benjamin and Nicholas Davies. You get the book and the talk at the historic Hillside Club from December 1st that I had the honor of hosting with Medea. Any amount pledged in right now, folks, in the waning moments of this show today, gets you the holiday audio collection, Storytelling for Social Change, where we honor our elders at KPFA. Also, Howard Zinn, who would have been 100 this year, 100 years old this year in the People's History of the United States, still one of the most significant and influential books. It's a very significant and important work. You can hear Howard Zinn talk about it in that audio collection. For any amount, pledge to KPFA right now. 800-439-5732. Please call now or go online to kpfa.org. Keep the calls coming, folks. And remember, as Smedley Butler said, war is a racket.
Hi, this is Robert Reich. I used to be Bill Clinton's Secretary of Labor. I'm now a professor at the University of California, Berkeley. I want to urge everyone who is listening to contribute to KPFA. In these difficult times, I cannot imagine living in a world without KPFA. KPFA's unique approach, insights, social criticism, vitally, vitally important. And we all have, it seems to me, a very strong obligation to make sure that KPFA survives and even thrives. So please, make a contribution, make it now, and keep KPFA going. Thank you.
Donate today by calling 1-800-439-5732 or online at kpfa.org. Howard Zinn.
Orwell said that whoever controls the past controls the future. And whoever controls the present controls the past. So whoever is in charge of our society can decide what our history will look like. And by deciding what our history will look like, they will decide our future. Well, that made history very important to me because it meant that history was not disengaged from society, that to create a more democratic history meant that you were at least playing some part in trying to create a more democratic society.
Storytelling for Social Change on KPFA.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online worldwide at KPFA.com.